any organization. It doesn't matter whether it's a for-profit or not-for-profit, any organization. The organization has to start. There is always a beginning. We have to start an organization. And once we have an organization, there are two things which matters for an organization, unless otherwise you have another choice. The two big things is the scale. All of us, we have our own ventures, sometimes we have own programs. What we want to do is, we want to scale this, we want to grow, we want to scale. And we want to scale to an extent that there is a bigger impact that we can see, we can feel that impact, and particularly in a social organization, we want to see that bigger difference that is going to happen or will happen through our venture or through our, you know, organization. Once we grow, once we scale, the next big thing is sustainability. So always I see that there are three S's which are very important for any organization. One is the beginning, that is the start. And then we need to grow and scale. That's the scale. And third is that scale is not enough. Can we have scale that can sustain over a period of time? And of course, we want to continue to grow while we scale our organization. So when we say that we want to scale an organization, it is not easy. Always we want to scale, we want to grow, we want to make a bigger impact, we want to sustain, we want to expand to different geographies. Beginning is easy, start is easy, but when we want a scale to happen and sustenance to happen, it is not easy. And sometimes I wonder, you know, when we ask in India, how many organizations have scaled and created an impact at a very larger scale? Again, the scale is also very relative. The scale for a Canada may be very different, or a scale for a Boston may be very different, and scale for an India or a scale for a one province might be very different. So to achieve that scale, one has to go through several stages of struggles and problems and pain points and so on. And there are many, many challenges that we encounter when we start. So in this particular panel, we have a special guest. I'm using the word special guest because he doesn't talk in 100,000s. He doesn't talk in 1 million. I have not heard him speaking ever 1 million. He always talks 100 million, 200 million, 500 million, billion. Do you know who works, you know, in such an organization, which always talks in millions and billions, hundreds of millions and billions? It should be a World Bank. Great. So we have a very, very special guest, Dr. Mokhlesur, Rahman. He has been an economist. He worked in the United States, and now he heads education and skills programs in Asia. He's based out of Dhaka. Dr. Rahman, it has been a great pleasure to have you. It's the first visit to Development Dialogue. Therefore, there's a special introduction for you. And he has seen many initiatives, many organizations who have scaled, and also many times who have failed and not able to scale. I think he's going to give us lot of insights about his global experience, not only in, say, in Bangladesh, but China, Cambodia, Philippines, and many other things. And he was,
you know, when he came here as a student, as a fellow, and today he's the deputy director in one of the initiatives, and he has done amazing work in Agri. So we have all kinds of right people with us to share their experience, their challenges, and how did they overcome, you know, those challenges so that they could scale and sustain. But, you know, I started with a, you know, comment saying that we want to do this differently, and the other moderator we have is Ram. Ram is going to ask a lot of follow-up questions because he understands and he knows that what an organization goes through. So I will just make an introduction and I will initiate this conversation, this particular session, and then Ram is going to shoot lots of questions so that we get those nuggets, those insights, so that we can understand how we can, you know, take our organizations from a small organization to all the way a scale, whatever scale that we want to, and the kind of an impact that we want to have. So I request all the panelists to come on the stage, and also my co-moderator.
So there is, you also missed. Okay. One of the things that came through, like if you want to really scale an organization, that's in any organization, doesn't matter whether it's for-profit or non-profit, because I went to the other panel after this panel was. One of the things that came through was, if you really want to have scale, we need to have audacious goals. If your goals are not audacious by nature, there is no way that you'll think scale. So that was the first message consistently given by the panelists in the morning. And then the new stand, we have a startup dialogue going on there. The new entrepreneurs that we are encouraging to start their enterprises in Hubli, they got the same message too. So the thing here is that all of us have scale as a problem. And the panel heading, it says nemesis of scaling, right? So basically there's a devil's advocate playing all the time who actually wants to stop you from scaling your organizations. So, and each of us have different challenges, and I would probably ask Aravind to start the whole.
So we're going to, you know, share their experience about the scaling up and how did they overcome. So we'll start this conversation with, you know, how did they begin? What has been their journey? And with that introduction, then we will get into very specifics about the challenges that they went through and how did they overcome the challenges and, of course, able to scale.
Sure. Yeah, thanks for having me here. Thank you. Well, I want to start this with a quote that my guru, Sri Bhagwan, told me. He said, birth pranks are painful. Right? I'm sure a lot of women here know that. But then you kind of go through it willingly because you are giving a new life. So for me, building a company, be it for profit or not for profit, is equivalent to that. Right? It is going to be painful, but how am I going to do that? Right? So that's a challenge that I started with. I said, how do you really do this conception? You know? So what is it that we need to do? So how do I really ensure that I think deep right at the stage of conception so that my organization can grow, transform? So it started as a self-reflection. Then I said, whatever I have developed, I mean my team has developed, we said this is something that can actually scale. That's when we started this company, iEnabler. So today we work with startups, we work with large enterprises. So the message is very simple. So how do you kind of conceive, you know, how do you really think deep? Today we had Amit talking about systems thinking, right? So how do we embed this mindset in the early days, be it for profit or not for profit? So that's something that I'm going to share with you today. So like the name, Innovation Enabler, I'm going to leave you with a couple of techniques that you can actually go and start doing.
So I am Damodaran from Gramalaya NGO, working for the WAS sector. Good afternoon to all. Thanks to the moderator, the panel members, and the participants in this conference. So Gramalaya was started in the year 1987, almost 30 years ago. For the last 3 decades, we have been working only for water, sanitation, and hygiene. And recently, for the past 3 years, we are concentrating more on menstrual hygiene management and nutrition. It is called the 5 pillars of sanitation: water, sanitation, hygiene, then menstrual hygiene and nutrition. It is called the WASMAN approach in short form. And we have constructed more than 200,000 toilets over the 25 years when we actually started our sanitation program. And for when we have faced some problems of financial crisis, getting subsidy from the government for the toilet construction in the rural areas, we have started a new entity called Guardian Microfinance Institution, which is giving loans for water and sanitation. So this is our history, and we are one of the approved national key resource center of the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation, and we are working in 5 southern states, including Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Telangana, and we are supported by CSR, corporates like Bank of America, Dasra, then HT Parekh Foundation through HTFC, all these things. And we are working in the rural areas as well as in the urban areas, tribal and coastal areas, in all terrains, exclusively for promoting household toilets. The toilet model we have promoted is called smart toilets, sustainable, maintainable, recyclable, appropriate and sustainable model we are promoting. That is called a zero waste toilet. The waste water from the bathroom is diverted for raising kitchen garden. Then the human excreta is recycled as manure and it is being used for gardening purpose. There is an incinerator in the toilet where women can dispose their used sanitary napkins. So there is a very new model we have created. And all our projects over the past 30 years, or I can say in 3 years, sustainable, successful, and scalable. Thank you so much.
So, good afternoon, everyone. So, my story is a little different because I came in 2011 as a student and joined Deshpande Educational Trust. But starting, I worked with Pradhan as a field staff. But my inspirations was always higher because I want to do something bigger. Many people laugh. So then I got chance here to start agriculture initiative with Deshpande Foundation because Deshpande Foundation used to support or work with partners. But when we talk about scale, so I don't want to take name, but we especially if we take farm ponds. So our partners say we want to do 10 in a year. Then next year they come with proposal, we want to do 15 tank in the next year. So today we have built around 4,200 tanks in 3 years. And each day we do 17 tanks, 100 by 100, 12, or each tank can irrigate 5 acres of land. So that's the scales we have done here. And then our model is not like more emotional. We take logical decisions. So our all operational cost comes from beneficiary, farmer. And we put a little capex cost. So it's a cost sharing model which can be sustainable. And today we work around 50,000 farmers on cotton, farm pond and chilies. So we'll be sharing how we are able to scale with 50,000 and next year we would like to do with 1 lakh farmers. So that's the story we will share. Thank you so much.
Personal experience in the 80s, in Bangladesh, let me start with Bangladesh. I'm working with 13 countries, and each country has a story. And in the 80s, an NGO had a little trial on how to get the girls in the school, secondary school. And at the time, the enrollment for girls, 27%. If some fund that NGO got from USAID, I did this study. That finished in 84. In 85, EU has come up with GEA. They have given some more fund. And 3 sub-districts have tried it. And I have seen there are good successes. Some model has come up. Then no action. Fund finished, work finished. Then I have continued that study and monitoring. And finally, as a researcher, I have come up at the national level, a keynote paper I presented. The then finance minister was the chief guest. So I told him that if you want to change the country's economic development, you need to bring the girls to the school. What is the model? So you have to provide stipend and tuition free for the girls. So do you have any model in the world? No. That's the first model you can try. So I had to beg him for money. And finally, he has agreed. Okay. Then at the time, I was not working with World Bank. I was a consultant. Then I convinced the bank whether we can do it. So it has started from 1 sub-district, then 3, then 127. Within 93, 127. And 95, government actually expanded it to all the sub-districts of the country. By 2008, primary enrollment more than boys. 2011, secondary 53%. girls, and the country got the award from UN for gender parity, MDG award. And that the model now replicated in 70 countries. Thank you very much.
We'll do that some other time. But before I ask a question here, how many of you are run for-profits and how many of you are part of non-profits? For-profits. How many of you are for-profits here? Okay. And how many of you are non-profits? Oh, we have a good balanced one here. So let me start with Sai Damodaran here. And before I ask him a question, I wanted to tell him a small experience. Not mine, but another person who told. This is in Nepal. Guy went to Kathmandu, and from there he had to take another flight to another place. It was about an 8-hour drive, but he took a chartered flight from Kathmandu to and went to that village. But what happened was, while returning, the chartered flight went in repair. He could not go back, but he had to drive back, so by in a taxi. So the guy sat in the taxi. 2 hours later, the taxi driver stops at a restaurant, and he says, please use the restroom. Everyone gets down, gets on, has a rest, and goes to the restroom, comes back. Another drive, because it's a very tough terrain, a lot of mountains and everything else, it takes almost 10 hours to reach. So he goes, another goes for another 2 hours. Again, the driver stops for a break and says, go to use the restroom. Okay. So now, they, okay, fine, take this as a, this one, saying that it might not be available on the way or something like that. They do that, and they come back. They stay in the jeep again. They travel for another 2-3 hours again, and that fellow, the driver stops the car and says, please go to the restroom. And now these guys are getting irritated. And he says, why? What do you mean? Why should I go to the restroom every time? So what are you talking about? So but this guy, at least more curious, he goes to the restrooms and sees what's happening there. He sees a blue pipe going from the urinals under this one towards the restaurant, where it's there. Okay? And that thing lands in the kitchen, the pipe. Now he's worried, actually, is what's happening and all this stuff. He goes and asks this guy, he says, what's happening? What are you guys are doing? So what they've done is, they've done a model where the restroom is kitchen, the stove is fired by the methane gas from the human excreta from the restroom. The higher restroom usage, they get more gas in the kitchen. So now, that's recycling for you. I actually come from a recycling company, but that's another point. But to come back to Sridhar, okay, now we are talking about now I'll talk to Gramalaya first, because they're into water and sanitation, and they've talked about Swachh Bharat and toilets here, right? The first question that I wanted to do is, you're a 30-year-old organization, but you did most of your work in the last 3 years. Okay. No, but how much toilets you built before Swachh Bharat, and how many toilets you built after Swachh Bharat?
Before Swachh Bharat, we have considered more than 100,000 toilets. After Swachh Bharat, over the past 10 years, we have constructed nearly 1 lakh toilets.
Basically, it took you 20 years to do 100,000, and another 5 to 7 years took 100,000. So, which means there is a scale that happened.
That is possible because of the microfinance I have engaged in providing loans for water and sanitation.
So, it is the finance which helped you to scale, or is it the government that helped you to scale?
Finance. Okay. The microfinance.
So your organization now works only in the southern states of India. Mm. Now, if you want to scale to the northern states, would you be willing to do it, or you don't want to do it?
Yeah, we are looking for another 5 states in the northern part of India. So our 10 priority states are in India. Already we have covered 5 states.
What is stopping you from doing it today?
No, actually we have trained more than 100 NGOs in the sector over the past 25 years. And also microfinance institutions currently engaged around 20 microfinance institutions are providing loans for sanitation in northern India also. So we want to move further 5 states in the northern part of India.
Okay, the reason I asked this question to Sai Damodaran is because of the tagline that we have got here. It says, collaborating for big bets. Now, India's program of sanitation for school or colleges, even though it was supposedly a political gimmick, has actually changed the way people go to schools. I mean, kids go to schools across the country. We may actually take away the politics for a moment out of the discussion. But having said that, it is a fact that the number of toilets that has increased in the school has actually encouraged attendance to schools as well. Mm. And one of the things that I would like to ask Sai Damodaran here is, apart from the villages, yeah. do you have plans or what did you do in schools specifically
yeah.
or in general places, not so specifically?
Yeah. Actually, we are also working in the schools, government rural schools, where we have promoted girls-friendly toilets. Because in the school complexes, the toilets are provided without water or without privacy for the girl children to change their sanitary napkins, and also no hand washing facilities in the schools, and also no privacy for the girls for urinal and other toileting purposes. So what we have promoted under Bank of America CSR program, we have promoted girls-friendly toilets in the government schools, and it was done on an experimental basis over the last 2 years. And after the schooling, when the school girl children going to their houses, there were no toilets in their home. So we are also promoting household toilets with bathroom attached facilities. Normally, government of India is providing only toilet only model, 4x4 this size. But we are promoting 8x4 with an attached bathroom so that the children can use that place as their privacy and for bathing and for other toileting purposes.
This is an excellent way to look at a particular success. You know, now at every stage of a success or every stage of a growth, one has to look at what modifications, what new thing that we need to look at. For example, this is a you know, everyone is talking about toilets and they are just focused on creating that whatever 4x4 square feet toilet. But here is a small intervention or an innovation, you know, that can really change the way the scale and growth can happen. Very interesting. I think we would like to have or hear more on these kind of insights when we come to the next round of discussion.
Okay.
Innus Khan.
Thanks.
So, Innus, I mean, I know because, you know, being part of a foundation, the goals were very, you know, limited. And when I look at Naveen doesn't talk, you know, this 4 number, 5 number, 10 in a day, in a month or so on. And he always looks at the scale, you know, and rapid scale. But the best part about this scale or scalability is not just because you're dependent on CSR and grant. It is because the farmers are partners to your success. Please tell us your journey. And what kind of a challenges foundation encountered when you wanted to scale and when you wanted to, you know, get paid for creating, you know, those farm ponds and then also have a partnership. So what kind of an, you know, experience you went through? How did you deal with this? And please don't tell us the, you know, very obvious challenges, but something which generally, you know, not known.
Sure. So very well, the major challenges for us is team, because when you talk about charging farmer or having cost from beneficiary, so most of questions come from educated guys or team members ki why you want to charge, they are very poor, all these things. So that's the big challenge, shifting their mindset. So, but I believe because I have mobile, and if I want mobile, I need to pay for it. Why someone for pay for my mobile? So I realized that. So when we started, because why we are successful, one major reason, because this idea came from farmer. When we used to go or have a training or awareness program for farmers, so farmer asked us, sir, we know the water management, can you have something which we can store rainwater? So if you do, so okay, well, we will do. So we will pay something and you need to pay. So farmer say, okay, we want to pay for it. So that's the one part, farmer pay for it, because this idea came from the community and now idea owner by the community. That's the one thing. Other challenges, because in same area, government, Karnataka government run Krishi Bhagya scheme. So Krishi Bhagya scheme, so 100 by 100, 12 feet tank. So they give around like 1 lakh rupees subsidy free. And we charge farmer in same area. So if government not able to do the critical number and we are able to do, so government look us as a competitor. So many challenges comes, they don't want to support our farmer, all these things. But now we have the number or impact, so government looks very positively. So these two challenges I face personally, and now this program is demand-based. We no need to go for farmer. Farmer comes here and we have some conditions. Sir, if you have 50 farmer, then only we will go your village. And these are the critical things, because water and soil, if you work, so many dispute, many lot of things is there. If you have demand-based, they will filter panchayat or farmer only. So these are two challenges I face during this skill.
These are very deep insights. I think, you know, when you said shifting the mindset, then making them, you know, willing to pay and also demand for it, and the filtering happening. That's one part of the story. Second part of the story, you know, when we look at the scale, whenever we want to do the scale, there are two most important things, but I'm not going to say second thing, but the first thing is partnership with the government. But here you were competing with the government, but still you could, you know, succeed. And I'm sure now the government must be becoming a partner. Yes. Yeah.
So now, like, we realize, or we earlier realized it, because until unless you have critical numbers or impact, no one going to listen. So we have huge impact and government want to collaborate with us. And we also are very positive, because we understand that government has huge resources. And we have execution ability, because government somewhere lacking for execution part. So we can execute things and government can provide resource, so we can do like 10 million tanks in India.
Good. In fact, I wanted to ask what next. I think already you said millions. Sridhar, just two things that I want to, you know, ask you. So you heard this, you know, mindsets and change in the mindsets. And there are competitors and then partnerships and so on. So based on your experience, you know, what has been the impact so far? And were these kind of a challenges you had to face, or did you face something else which is very critical for all of us to know?
Right. See, the kind of companies that we work with at different stages of growth, be it startup, growing companies, enterprise, most of them kind of outsource their thinking to someone else. A large enterprise wants to depend on the big four to think for them. They believe they're all execution leaders, right? That's how they have branded them. So when I go there and I put them in a room and say, now you got a thing, they say, when are you going to leave me? So I like something that Akshay Patra Foundation CEO said very recently. I call that statement as ideal strategic intent. He said, I want to feed 5 million people with the government subsidy. I don't want a penny to go out from Akshay Foundation. This is what is called ideal strategic intent. If you all have a piece of paper and pen, just make a note of this formula. This is going to work magic. This is what I quote CEOs. So ideal strategic intent, think of a numerator. Numerator is all about the useful functions, right? Numerator is all about the useful function. The denominator is about all the harmful functions plus all the cost items that have gone into it. We have at the numerator all the useful functions, and in the denominator you have all the harmful function plus cost, and I want my denominator to be zero, which means I am talking about infinite useful functions. Can you kind of conceive this for your own startups? Can you conceive this for your own NGOs, right? I want to have all the useful functions. I want to take away all the harmful functions, and I want to ensure that cost is negligible or zero. If you start with this strategic intent, then ideas will pour. That's why I said, right at the conception stage, you know, we have to be ready with this, right? Yeah, so this is something that I kind of help people in doing.
Excellent, Sridhar, because, you know, you applied one of the principles of TRIZ.
That's right.
So TRIZ is a inventive problem solving, which was developed in Russia by a very well-known person called Altshuler. And very nicely you articulated so well.
Yes.
I think this is one of the golden nuggets or principles of a problem solving.
Right.
So I think please get ready for your questions. You know, after I, you know, asked a question to Dr. Rahman. Dr. Rahman, you heard all these things. You know, very interesting things and deep insights. So based on your experience of working with, say, 13 countries,
or most of the Asian countries, large like China, India, plus a smaller country like Cambodia. So was there any particular problem that you felt was a critical problem in the scale, and that particular problem was solved very creatively, innovatively, or with an ingenious way? Do you have something to share?
Also add, at the level of scale that World Bank operates, which are the projects that you could not do?
Thank you very much. Again, I think I need to say something on the World Bank and how World Bank itself has no existence. All the countries are the member of the World Bank. So ultimately, all of you are owner of the World Bank. And what World Bank does, it actually collects the knowledges across the world and apply it and adopt it to a country which is feasible. And World Bank, as is a large institution, sometimes you will hear a lot of negative newses, and actually it does many, many good things. For example, in India, you can see the IIT, IIM, polytechnics, even education for all, and even livelihood projects, energy projects. These are all helping the people, empowering the people. When World Bank look into the country, it look into its capacity, people capacity. Based on the people capacity, it determines how it will help the country to the next level. Look at this, even this India. Now it is no more getting concessional credit from the World Bank, because it is graduated. Why it is graduated? You can see the people lifestyle, economic activity, it has improved. It has to go next level. Next level is a really, really tough time. It is now middle income country. It needs to be high income country. For going there, a country needs at least 60% skilled people. Does India have 60% skilled manpower? Answer is no. How to do it? Come up with a strategy. The idea you are generating, people has to be skilled, deliver the best, so that the country narrative need to be changed. That's the way World Bank look into across the world. And I just like to, as you have pushed me for another example, I did work with fragile country like Afghanistan. I have seen education is a magic. Without education, a nation can't be move forward. When I have started working there, do you believe illiterate teacher? Is it possible? Teacher, but not literate. I have introduced illiterate teacher in Afghanistan because they don't have teachers who can write, but they know their language. They can teach the young, and there was a 15-year plan. They have 70% teachers. They can somehow read and write. 30% they can't write. After 3 years, they have started learning how to write. And now still they have 5% illiterate teacher. And the way I have started working, again, scaling things are coming up. Around 100,000 girls are in the school. Now around 5 million. The model, social model we have developed, bringing across the world. I was one of the person who actually implemented and fine-tuned it. So what we have seen that now the education is transforming the society. So what I believe that whatever we do, keep in mind empowering the people, giving them skill and right education, and we do not need to push them every time. They will drive themselves, and the country will be much better whatever is today. Thank you very much.
That's
In my career, I did, it's my 50th project going on. I have one failed project and 49 successful project. And a lot of project got UN award, national award. And that's the difficulty for me to say any failed thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you being so honest and also sharing something about Afghanistan, because these are the countries generally we don't get to know. But so I think now that at a higher level we understand, you know, what it takes to scale and what challenges, but we need to get into, because you see, this is such a big audience. They want to hear nuts and bolts. How did actually you did it? What made, what circumstances, what context, what situations? How did you bring the change and shift and then scale? So let's open up. Now our discussion is not at a higher level, no? Because the rest, another 15-20 minutes, we go deeper into the conversation.
By either contractor and government, the cost is 1,90,000 to 1,00,000. If any farmer want to construct tank, the cost will be 35,000 to 40,000 with Deshpande Foundation. Because of the region, because we have skilled drivers who know the how to do slope, all these things. And then a good machinery and team. These are the these things. That's why farmer can save 60 or 50% money and they want to come with us. So I think like 10% cost we have reduced, not much. Not much.
Okay, Innus, the question here is, you started with 30,000 rupees. The question that he's asking is, why are you not able to bring it to 20,000 rupees? Not concession, cost.
Other things, because of the machinery. So you don't know when machine, even is a new machine, because you need 36 hour to 40 hour for constructing 100 by 100 12 feet tank. If you can deliver it in 32 hours with more efficient manner, so here we need to use some technology, a part which we are working on that. Otherwise, by it's like very difficult. And you only can... Now we only can reduce 10% or 15%. That's the like max, very minimum cost.
Okay, that is one part of the answer. But being part of the foundation, let me answer the question differently. We are actually not, the whole idea of the foundation here is no charity. What we are here is for social innovation and social impact. And the society and the community has to participate in all the solutions that we provide. One of the first things is sustainable solution. So which effectively means, unless the community participates in it, we cannot make it sustainable. So what we did was, when we put together this project, as part of this whole thing together, we worked out the manpower cost of everything else. The machines came from donations from Tata's and Infosys Foundation and a whole bunch of other companies. And we also bought a few as part of that. And having bought that, we only wanted the maintenance and the operating cost to be borne by the farmers. So we did it bottoms up. So when you do it bottoms up, actually the cost is supposed to go up, because we are paying, our salaries of the drivers are going up, fuel costs keep changing, the way we do things, there is inflation. So basically the cost would have gone up by 6% on an overall basis, the inflation rate, and all the salary costs that we are doing, because we are just recovering cost here and not necessarily looking to bring down the cost of an operation. And that's the... a reason we are able to scale.
Yeah, with regard to the toilet constructions, actually 15 years ago we have promoted low cost toilets. So that means we have promoted even zero cost toilets. I will tell at a later stage. The toilet cost will range from 500 rupees to 5000 rupees 15 years ago. But nowadays we are promoting cost effective toilets. Cost effective toilets are durable toilets and also sustainable toilets. And you can even certify in the CSR project, the toilet will last for 25 years. That kind of strength and durability of quality standards in construction, we are ensuring that one. Apart from that, but when we are comparing our cost of operations, our operational cost earlier 30%, now we are reduced to 5%. So that kind of cost reduction we are ensuring in our project. Wherever we work, and Gramalaya is not directly implementing the project, we empower the CBOs, the community-based organizations, where we are forming boss committees and boss committees, association for water, sanitation and hygiene committees. So those committees are empowered to execute the project at the field level. So wherever money at any scale comes, we will just transfer the funds to the trained CBOs after capacitate them. So they will execute the project. And from our organizational side, we will monitor the project on quality and quantitative aspect. So that way we are maintaining the impact of the program. And there is a post-survey and pre-survey before start our project. So that way we could be able to know the...
So do you have an audit mechanism also to ensure that the money goes to the right places?
Yes, sir. And we maintain 100% transparency in transferring our accounting system as well as auditing the CBO's accounts. That way we are maintaining.
I think this is a very, very important point. Many times we think that the scale will happen if I reduce the cost. It will not. I will just briefly, you know, very briefly share a story. I think it's a very important, it's a real story. There was an organization which was providing, you know, purified water in the villages. They had a technology. I will not get into the technology. So he said, the organization said, the cost of producing this purified water is 5 paise. He said, even if I sell it 10 paise, I think people should be able to buy. And he started going door to door to sell. Nobody was willing to buy in rural parts of India. He discovered, where is the problem? When I'm willing to give such a low cost, high purity water, why people are not willing to pay? He realized, I think it was 50 paise or something. He realized that people, even in rural India, have aspirations. What rural people, they compared with the urban people or the people who have more disposable income, what they compared was, you know, in the city, people pay 10 rupees for a liter. We can pay 1 rupee per liter of a water. The moment the water cost was increased to 1 rupee and there was such a big sell and he could expand the whole organization. So we need to include that aspirational aspect also, just not the cost. But in terms of the productivity, efficiency and all these things, I think it makes sense that we keep reducing the cost of this.
This sandbox was started 10 years ago. What we encouraged people was that if you have a social impact idea, and we're pretty serious about it, if you want to be a social entrepreneur, you better be prepared to give at least 7 years of your life. There is no small short-term solutions in social impact. Anyone who says that I can build a solution in less than 6 months is actually walking on air. It's impossible, and we have learned it, not just the hard way, we have seen it happen. There's a whole bunch of more than 1,000 people who have gone through this sandbox over the last 10 years. What we tell them is, if you have a social impact idea and you know that you can scale, come here, experiment, work with us. We are giving you a living laboratory of 10 million people. The ecosystem can absorb that solution. And if you can show scale, we will figure out a way to work with the government. Now, if you take Pradhan, you take Gramalaya or a whole bunch, Agastya Science Foundation, there's a whole bunch of organizations that have gone through, organizations like Sandbox and Akshaya Patra, for instance. If a lot of people think Akshaya Patra is a charity organization, okay? That's the last thing that they do. The whole objective of Akshaya Patra is not free food. The objective of Akshaya Patra is to get kids to school. There's a huge difference between saying that I'm giving away one meal and I'm doing charity. People get flyers saying that please donate $750 and you're feeding a child. Actually, the tagline which we have asked them to do is to say that give $750 and send a kid to school. That impact has been seen here in Hubli itself when a couple of years ago, the Intel Science competition was won by a kid from the government rural school in Hubli. All because that guy went to school. Okay, so now it's not a fact, and all of us should understand that government is the largest spender in the country. Any country, government will be the largest spender on community. And working with government is one of the most toughest things to do, but we have to figure out ways and means. As Kishore said in another conference today morning, there is ethics and there is way to work, and we have to bridge the gap.
You'll have to kind of involve them in the entire project. Right, the CSR, working with you. This is where we were talking about systems thinking today. If we can kind of map what is happening in the super system, if we can kind of map what is happening in the subsystem and show them value, I'm sure corporates will respond to it. I see a lot of CSR response being very positive these days. I'm not taking names, but then I'm seeing companies really doing good job. I think it's about that mapping.
our experience for the past 5 years, actually most of the corporates willing to support any kind of NGOs or any kind of the five mentioned sector, development sector. But what they want, they want to do performance, due diligence. So in the due diligence, they want the good track record NGOs and something they have successfully done at the field level, they want to do that. Another thing is, there is a need to connect with right kind of corporates and the NGOs. There is a gap, you are right. These are the two things I have found.
That they will work with. One of the best reports that if you want to see in India, read the ITC sustainability report. Okay, so IT is a cigarette company, whether we like it or not. Okay, and even today, close to 50% is cigarette revenues, tobacco revenues. But they're transforming themselves. At the same time, the amount of work that they do on sustainability and the work they do on CSR has to be tied. So if you are an NGO working on one sector which is not in line with their vision, it's unlikely that you will be considered. Okay, so that's a fact of life, because as much as they want to spend the 2%, there's a branding issue here. So let's understand there's a brand issue behind this. So if you want to be an NGO and you want to CSR money, we have to also be aligned with what we want to do along with the brand that they are.
There are community toilets constructed by the government in the urban area. We are working in the Trichy city in Tamil Nadu. And the earlier days, the government built the community toilets and they just maintain it, but it will spoil within 6 months. But we have promoted self-help groups. Women self-help groups were motivated to take up the community maintenance of the toilets under pay and use system. They are charging 50 paise, 1 rupee or 2 rupee like that for the maintenance. And using the revenue, they are maintaining the toilet group sustainably over the past 15 years. Gramalaya withdrawn from the project in 2008. Till today, the project is going on by a federation called Women Wave Federation.
Quality versus quantity, any comment?
Quality and quantity, we have to form systems and procedures.
Wherever you use, systems and processes.
You have to make the standard operating procedures of like World Bank.
So,
I will tell one more thing, okay, sir. This is a model we are promoting, and Pondicherry government now is scaling up this one. They have got our model, and they have scaled it up more than 20,000 toilets over 1 year period. They have changed the government 4x4 toilet model, and completely is a bathroom attached toilet model. One more thing, sir. One minute. Huh? I will tell another story on MHM, menstrual hygiene management. We have introduced field-free cloth pads, reusable and washable cloth pads for women, because wherever we go to the school, the children don't find a place to change their napkins. Also, they are throwing it in the open. It's very not good. So we have introduced field-free cloth pads, washable and reusable, trash-free, cash-free and rash-free. Thank you so much.
Excellent. I think these are the innovations, great innovations. Coming from Gramalaya, and that's where you see the scale, that's where you see the growth, you will see the sustenance and also the impact. You know, the session is not over yet. You know, we have a very esteemed colleague here from Boston Foundation, and she has been watching us. She's an observer, and she's going to give, you know, her comments and her summary, and then we will close the...
Okay. Now, the role of capital, that the question that was there, let me answer that, because... Morning, you heard Desh saying that there are two ways of running an NGO. One is you take an NGO and impact only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people or just a small village and don't bother about scale. But do whatever you're doing, doing pretty well as much as possible, and then you try to make it sustainable in that particular location. But if you want to scale, then it's a different ballgame altogether. So now, unless you figure out as to whether you want to do it in the first place, and you have a team which is strong enough to support you, don't do it. But if you think that actually speaking that you would be able to build the team and the solution is scalable. First of all, the solution that you do here may not be necessary or relevant for some other place. If you are in the wrong place, you're going to get messed up anyway. So the idea here is that role of capital is the last thing that you do when you do a social innovation. The role of capital is the top first when you do a corporate solution, because that's a different thing altogether. The ROI measurement in a social innovation project is very, very different when you do it for a for-profit. And when you do it for a non-profit, its social impact is the measurement, is the first, then the ROI comes in. But it's a for-profit and you want to look at it as a for-profit, and I think that that's what you want to do, then it's a different thing altogether.
I'm actually, my name is Kate Guedj. I'm from the Boston Foundation in Boston, Massachusetts. And my role there is to work with donors and individuals to enhance their own philanthropy. The Boston Foundation brings people and resources together to solve problems. And last year, we distributed $140 million in grants all over the world. I also have the great honor of being a member of the Deshpande Foundation Board of Directors and have watched over a dozen years as the impact has grown from that work. I'm not going to do a concluding summary. A one-hour session gives you the opportunity to open Pandora's box, and it's very hard to close it. So I thought I'd just give a little bit of reflection on scaling from my perspective. I've been in the field for 30 years, and it really hasn't been until about 15 years ago that the concept of scaling within nonprofits became a thing, and we all began talking about it, and it's accelerated beyond that. So I wanted to take a minute and step back. As I thought about this session, I actually decided, well, let me Google that. What is scaling? What does Google say? And interestingly, Google brought me to Wikipedia, another great resource, and brought me to geometry, which I thought was an interesting place to be to land. And from geometry, scaling means a linear transformation that enlarges or diminishes objects in proportion. Then I looked up, I thought, well, that's not all that helpful. So although it is interesting as a metaphor where the concept came from, so I Googled scaling nonprofits. And I kid you not, the first entry read, and I quote, "Why Indian nonprofits are experts at scaling up." And it was a citation from the Stanford Social Innovation Review, otherwise called SSIR, co-written in part by Amit Chandra from this morning. I would commend you to that article. You just Google scaling nonprofits and you'll get it. And I would say that throughout the day, we've heard from experts about scaling, and today we tried to talk about the nemesis of scalings. And although I come from a very different context in the United States, the challenges are some are quite similar within the U.S., where frankly we have a lot to learn from India. And the SSRI, in fact, noted that, and I quote, "There might be no better laboratory than India for studying the challenges that nonprofits face in trying to scale up when resources are scarce. And there might be no better guide than Indian nonprofits for how to overcome those challenges and become effective agents of social change." It goes on to lay out five recurring mindsets that need to be in place to really scale a nonprofit. And I would note none of them are money. It's about mindsets for scaling. India, like no other place that I know, takes scale to a whole different level. And as one of the nonprofits leaders profiled in the SSIR article concluded from the article, I'm sick and tired. This is someone else talking. I am sick and tired of nonprofit leaders getting turned on by 45% growth. All that means is growing from 22 schools to 32 schools. Compared to the need, 32 schools is irrelevant. Even 10,000 is barely relevant. What is relevant is 600,000 schools. So I come from a very different context, and in that context, I have become fond of thinking about a proverb that its origins I don't know, and if anybody in the room does know, please let me know, about the starfish. It's a little, and in summary, there's starfish that are starting to wash up on a beach. An old man comes and sees all this desperate starfish clearly dying on the beach. But there's a little boy there, and he's taking each starfish one by one and flinging them into the sea. But there are thousands of starfish. And the old man said, "What good is that doing?" And the little boy said, "Well, it matters to that one." And I think of that as I counsel people in their philanthropy over and over again. I mean, on the one hand, you could call it charity. On the other hand, it is making a difference in somebody's lives. But yet, at the same time, we do want to know what that red tide is and how we can cure it through social change philanthropy. And I just would conclude by saying that the Stanford Social Innovation Review clarion call to keep an eye on the need really felt very strongly to me. And it's fundamental, I think, to our sector. But remember, that need might be 600,000 schools. It probably is. But it also may be in the eyes of one child. For the lessons in scale, there's nothing like India for an outsider. I have a great, profound, and enduring respect for what is happening here, and learn every time I come. And let it be said that if India can do it, we all must. So thank you.
For me, scale and sustainability is a very important for India and many parts of the world. Look at the population. There are 2.6 billion people whose income is less than $2 a day. It's almost 40% of the population today is in a situation where they can't even get the very, very basic necessities of life, like water, sanitation, food, financial inclusion, healthcare, education, and so on. And for this, it is not that we should just take examples of few organizations who have scale, but I think it is equally important that we learn from that scale organization, but we ourselves have to ensure that we build the organizations that scale and sustain and make a difference to the world that is 40% of the population. But whatever solutions that you develop for this so-called bottom of the pyramid has a very, very big relevance to the rest of the world. So thank you very much for your active participation. Thank you very much. At this stage of a day, I was just looking at all of you and you were listening so intensely. So that intensity of your listening, learning, interacting gives me a tremendous hope for the better world. Thank you very much.